God is our refuge and strength, in very present help and trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, even though the earth be removed,
and though
the mountains be towering in the midst of the sea, though the waters roar and be troubled, though the mountains shake with the swelling, there is a river. Whose streams shall make glad the city of God, the holy place of the tabernacle of the Most High, God is in the midst of her. She shall not move. God shall help her. Just at the break of dawn,
all
right, the nations reign. The kingdoms were moved. He uttered his voice, and the earth melted. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Come, behold the works of the Lord, who have made desolations in the earth. He maketh wars to cease to the ends of the earth. He breaketh the bow and cuts the spear in two. He burns the chariots in the fire. He still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob.
A special and pleasant good morning again to you, members of the family of our dearly beloved sister, Marjorie Jemmett, and to all you friends, loved ones, and relatives that have come to be with us as we celebrate the life of indeed one that we can say within our church, she can be regarded as an icon. She was very well loved within this church, present at every possible occasion for every event, every meeting with both young and old. She was never missing, and more often than not, she was always the first to be there, herself along with another dearly departed sister, Sister Blenman. So today I want to express sincerest condolences to all the family members, all the friends of Sister Jemmett, and let you know that our church indeed wish you well. We pray that God indeed will draw close to you as you go through this time of grieving, this time of hurt, that you would remember the life she lived and see it as an example and fully Christian life, and be assured that God reserves a place in his eternal kingdom for those who are his. That does not exclude you. You can be his if you make that choice to follow him all the way as she did. Let us now bow for prayer as we pray to start the service. Father in heaven, great God, what a wonderful, loving, lovely Lord you are. We thank you, Lord, for your loving kindness and for your tender mercy, for your watch care and your protection over us. Thank you, Lord, for every good and perfect gift that comes down from heaven by your hand. We thank you, Lord, for the life of our dearly departed sister, Sister Jemmett. We know that as she lies there, that all is silence to her. She hears nothing. And we can say nothing to her that she will hear. Neither can she speak to us. But Lord, we have an opportunity to speak and commune one with each other. And we can reflect on all the wonderful experiences that we've had with this wonderful individual, this woman of the Lord. And we can indeed seek to emulate and live a life that she lived, one that was dedicated 100%, 150% to the Lord. And so, Lord, today we ask that you would draw dear, near and dear to all of her family, Garfield and all the very close relatives, sisters, and all the children and grandchildren, that all of them will be comforted at this time of loss, and that indeed they would continue to lean upon your everlasting arms in times like these. We pray, Lord, that you would bless all the church family as well, God. Indeed, we too are grieving because this is a space that is left. She would always be sitting at that back section at the back of the church, and now that spot, when we look down there, there'll be no more Sister Jemmet. But we are comforted that there's coming a time when the dead in Christ will rise, and we who are alive and remain will be caught up to join those that are dead in Christ in the air and be forever with the Lord. And so we pray that you would be near to this family, place your hands and provide for them abundantly above all that they can think, ask, or desire. Comfort them, Lord, with all of heaven's blessings. Surround them with your love. Let them feel your presence near, Lord. And Lord, when the days are dreary and long and they feel sad about Sister Jemmet, help them to reflect on a life well lived. May they be comforted that she will in time be resurrected to a better place. Bless and keep them all of her family, relatives, and friends. Continue to be with them and let your light shine upon them and be gracious unto them, we pray. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You may sit. The hymn of comfort, number 462, will now be played by the media. 462. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Sing. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a fortress of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God. Born of the Spirit, washing his blood. This is my story, this is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. Purpose is a mission, perfect delight. Visions of rapture numbers on my sight. Angels descending bring from above echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my story, this is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. Mission, all is at rest. I in my Savior, I'm happy and blessed. Watching and waiting, looking above. His goodness, lost in his love. This is my story, this is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song. Praising my Savior. Amen.
I invite now your attention to the monitor as a video is shown in a tribute from Maria and others.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Marcia Lithcott Danielle. Marjorie Jemmett, my aunt, better known as Auntie, was Auntie to everyone. She was the kindest person that I've ever known. She had a great sense of humor, sometimes very dry, and she loved to laugh. Auntie was there for us, whether it be babysitting when we were young or giving financial and moral support whenever she can. She was a good listener. She had the ability to interact with the young and the old. We still speak of the good deeds that Auntie has done for us. Auntie loved to socialize. Whenever and wherever there was a family gathering, Auntie was there. Auntie loved to go to the airport to bid farewell to whoever was returning abroad. All she needed to know was the date and the time of the departure, and she was there even before you arrive. She was courageous. She loved to travel. Even in her advanced age, she arrived in Canada ready for a new adventure. At 80 years old, I believe, or older, she visited England to see Uncle, who was ill at the time. I recall putting Auntie on a train from London to Manchester, traveling alone. We were hoping and praying that she would arrive safely after the three-hour journey. She was all smiles when Cousin Trevor picked her up at the other end. Auntie had a deep faith in God, and she did not like missing church on Saturdays. In Canada and in England, Auntie made sure she found a Seventh-day Adventist church that she can attend each Saturday. She quickly made friends, and very soon she was being picked up, taken to church, and brought back home by a church member. We will always remember our aunt. She is a unique person. There will never be another auntie because she is the last of her siblings. She will be greatly missed. On behalf of myself and Mac, Carrie and Akeem, Maria, Ariana and Malcolm, we are deeply saddened by Auntie's passing. We love you, Auntie. May you rest in the arms of the Almighty Father. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Maria Daniel, the great niece to Marjorie Jemmett, also known as Auntie to us and known as sister to the community. And my fondest memories of her were when she would come to the airport to see us off, or she'd be at the airport when we'd arrive, and she was always on the go with her big heavy bag that she carried absolutely everything in. She was incredibly hardworking, incredibly attentive, and so witty. Auntie was a jokester. She would always laugh, she would always smile, she'd always be telling stories. She loved to reminisce. She loved to share anecdotes. She was helping me build out the Jemmett family tree. She was so keen to talk. She was a really, really good person, really kind, really genuine, really honest, you know, never hold back what she thought. She was very honest. She was also very pragmatic. And when my grandmother, Gloria, passed, I asked Auntie how she was feeling about it, and she looked me dead in the eye and just said, when it's your time, it's your time. And that there's nothing to be afraid of. I know that she was accepting of death, and she knew that God had other plans for her, and she was ready. So she'll be sorely missed by us, by my family, by the community. She will be very missed.
I'm gonna get a picture of you. Say cheese.
Okay, there seem to be no one. Okay, well, come if you come, sis. Come to the podium. Trevor will sort you out. After these tributes, we'll have our scripture reading by Shakira Chase.
Sister. I would say my daughter gave birth to me. She brought her. My mom was living in the Long Gap, and she introduced her to me. But I had known her, but not acquainted with her, but just seeing her. So then we become friends. We go to the beach on mornings, done with the hot pot. Then she was able to walk, but then her foot gave out. She didn't able to walk down that distance no more. I would still go and call her on the phone. So she had a telephone there that something here would crack, 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 crack. I couldn't hear her. And I would fret. I said, "You call me. Because every time I call you, I can't hear you." Then she changed the phone. I went in town with her. She got the phone, got another phone. And I could go on, but I guess I had the opportunity to say. But I surely miss her, because I'm looking forward to talk with her again. A Wednesday, I called her, a Wednesday, I don't remember the day of the month, and she was laying down. I said, "You laying down? You not cooking today that you'll get some for tomorrow?" She said, "And you got to wash Thursday?" She said, "No, I ain't washing Thursday." But I know, to make a long story short, that I want to get back to talk to her again. But I tell you, very tidy and a neat person. You could go at her house anytime. Everything always in place. She has certain days to do certain things. She was a very kind person. She said, "I go there look for her." She said, "I nod. You come here to sleep and hear the hostel." She always make a joke, you know. I miss her. I will miss her. But you know, in life we can't live forever. But honestly, I was looking forward to talk to her again. She always give her grandson good things to him. When he work, he must save his money and try and get some of it to live. She always said, "How nice her granddaughter is there to bring kids and things and give her an assets like, may she rest in peace."
Amen. Amen, amen. Okay, Sister Colleen, you are coming. Okay, just sanitize their traps. Thank you.
Good morning to one and all. I was very blessed to have met Sister Gemma. I would call her sister. She was such a nice person to me and the young people in the church. Whenever they had programs, she's not anything to do with 35 and under. She is there to take part. You could ask her to pray or whatever. I remember going to her home to visit her. And I'm not a deaconess, but I went with Sister Olivia to take some communion. And she was so happy to have the communion. She was so happy. We prayed with her, and she also gave a little testimony at the end. Last birthday, I came to see her. I went to see her at home, and I told her, "Sister Gemma, I brought a wine for you. We're going to drink some wine, and we're going to celebrate the birthday." And I took the wine, we drank, and then after, we held hands and we prayed. That was in June this year. And I'm very happy for that, because that's a good memory. That's a sweet memory of Sister Gemma. I came there one day, and she was getting a massage. And a young lady was massaging her feet. And I said, "Sister, that's just a nice thing. You must have got to pay for this." She said, "Pay for this? No, man. This is my neighbor, you know?" And she said, "You know," I said to her, "but all the good deeds that you do, God is returning to you." I want to thank God for Sister Gemma. All the through the years, I remember once I went to see her, and she told me she was going to invite me for lunch. And she's such a strict Sunday Adventist, I must say, that I wanted to be like Sister Gemma. She would not wash a spoon on the Sabbath. She had all the dishes in the washed and covered in the fridge. And she had the tongs, whatever, to take out the salad, whatever. She said to me, "I don't do anything on Sabbath." She had the plate, she took them out, she gave me the lunch. We drank and we talked and things like that. And then we had to go back to AY in the evening, youth service in the evening. But I remember that incident all my life. And I said that I'm going to try my best not to do anything at all. She said, I do nothing on Sabbath. All I do is to worship, pray, go to church and come back and eat. She put everything in the sink. And when she said, after the Sabbath is over, I'm going to wash all these things. She said, don't wash a thing in here. Don't wash nothing in my place. I don't break the Sabbath. I put everything in there. So I want to emulate my life as a Sister Gemma. A sweet person and a kind person. Can call her anytime. She talked to me and ask me my children how they're doing. And I pray that I would live the life that comes so that when the earth made you, I can see her again. What a wonderful, wonderful lady. Thank you.
Okay, this time we'll have our scripture reading. Tribes, you want to standardize? Thanks.
Good morning. Scripture reading is taken from Revelation chapter 21, verses 1 to 5. And I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea. And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, Behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them and be their God. And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. And he that sat upon the throne said, Behold, I make all things new. And he said unto me, Write, for these words are true and faithful. Amen.
As we continue our service of thanksgiving for our dearly beloved, we'll have at this time an item of special music by Joyce Charles.
Good morning, church. Auntie really believed in her God and she served her God. And I'm sure you have heard her sometimes say, it will be worth it all when we see Jesus. So I sing this song this morning in tribute to Auntie.
Tears forever over in God's hands.
We want to thank you, Sister Charles, for that beautiful rendition. There's a passage of scripture which says, "Thou wilt keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on thee." I've quoted this passage of scripture because it speaks so eloquently of Sister Jimmett, whom I've known for most of my life as a family friend, mother of my buddy Garfield, and a child of God. I'm sure if it were possible for each person here this morning and those of you who are watching online, and you were asked to speak about our dearly departed, I'm confident that each of you would express genuine love for her. The AYs love her because she was the oldest member who, even in her 80s, as you heard, attended camp meeting with them. Elder Gittins, master builder and constructor of this church, love her because during the building of this church, she was present when the first dirt was turned for the foundation and when the last coat of paint for its finishing was applied. Brother Sean, he loved her as she, whenever available, accompanied him to many a church service. My mom, the late Joyce Spain, loved her as her constant church partner to all church activities, inclusive of singing band, Wednesday night prayer meeting, open air services, evangelistic programs, socials, picnics, VBS sessions, you name it, they were there. Her nieces and nephews love her, as you heard. And last, and by no means least, those of us who have had speaking appointments love her because we knew for sure if there was going to be one person to hear us, it would be Sister Jimmett. Madre Jimmett was born the 70th of June, 1929, the second child of Priscilla Jimmett. She was the mother of her only son, Garfield, aunt of 26 and great aunt of 11. She worked mainly as a housekeeper and was well respected by all those who were privileged to have her within their employment. As an ardent church member, she served as a deaconess for eons, it seemed. Jimmett, as she was affectionately called, was a person of few words, but was a deep thinker, as was evident by the responses she made during Sabbath school classes when called upon to share her views. Because of her honesty, she became the confidant of both the young and the aged. She always spoke the truth, no matter what. I know we've been admonished not to judge, but some room is given for us to be fruit inspectors. Hence, as a fruit inspector, I've evidenced love, joy, peace, patience, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, and self-control in Sister Marjorie Jimmett. Of course, you recognize there the fruit of the Spirit, which signifies the character of God, our only passport to heaven. Hence, I'm suggesting that we will meet our dearly departed in the sweet by and by. The Bible records Saul of Tarsus, a terrorist, holding the garments of the men as they stoned Stephen to death. Stay with me now. Can you imagine the smile of surprise that will be seen on Stephen's face as he sees Paul the apostle in glory land? Garfield, many were the prayers of your mother as she petitioned the throne of grace on your behalf. Please make sure, Garfield, that you put that smile on her face.
We will continue with the singing of number 205.
we see the gleams of the golden morning that will pass unto.
Shall we bow our heads for prayer? Dear kind and heavenly Father who art in heaven, today we stand in thankfulness for the blessings you have bestowed through the life and the ministry of our dear sister Marjorie Gemma. As she lays down the affairs of this life, Lord, we are thankful for your grace and mercy to every member of family. Remember her son. Remember, I pray, her grands and their relations. And Lord, in all, may their hearts be comforted in knowing not only the blessing she has bestowed through her life that continue in them, but Lord, may they also remember her hope in God. Amen. May they lay hold on the assurance of your word that those who trust in God through Jesus Christ lay a foundation for eternity.
Yes.
May we, together with them, prepare to meet you when you shall come. In Jesus' name. As I heard many testimonies of Sister Gemma, a word came to mind. The word is resilience. Resilience is said to be the ability or the process to adapt well when facing adversity, trauma, or tragedy. 92 years is not 92 days. And in 92 years, especially in the times in which she lived, there are many challenges and difficulties that Sister Gemma would have faced.
Yes.
We are facing a cultural resilience even at this time. COVID has caused us to have to adapt, not true?
Yes.
We've had to change the way we do things to the point that those of us who are touchy-feely have a lot of changes to make. But God has allowed us to adapt. And now we are more able to use the cell phone and the emojis than before. Now we're more able to relate to each other from a distance from before. But you know what I've realized? Now we seem to value more the ability to be together than we did before.
Yes.
Resilience not only is a cultural feature of facing the changing circumstances of the world, but it is also a social dynamic. As we relate to one another, we have to be resilient. Very often, tongue and teeth make words. And at times, there are situations that develop between us where we have to adapt and we have to adjust and we have to rise above the best and the worst of ourselves. Sister Marjorie was a lady of real circumstance. And by God's grace, she rose above her circumstance. The order and the discipline of her life was a constant decision in her experience to be who she chose to be in God. In Isaiah chapter 60, verse 1 to 3, one of those texts that would have inspired her heart, God challenges his people to arise and shine. To what? Now, I don't know about you, but we live in dark days.
Yeah.
We live in days where I have even been shown pictures where this very area has seen some dark scenes.
Yeah.
But God tells his people, don't become like the world, become better.
All right.
Arise and shine, for your light is come, and the glory of the Lord is risen upon thee. For behold, darkness shall cover the earth, and gross darkness the people. But the Lord shall arise upon thee, and his glory shall be seen upon thee. And the Gentiles shall come to thy light, and kings to the brightness of thy rising. I love to hear the testimony of family and friends of what Sister Gemma was able to portray and exemplify in her life. But she has done it as an illustration of what God can do for you. Generosity is good on the part of one. But if all were generous, what a world it would be. Forgiveness is good on the part of one. But what would the world be if we all could forgive? Love may seem hard, but we have seen that love faces challenges and overcomes. Not only do we have cultural and social resilience, but there must be spiritual resilience. There must be what? What is spiritual resilience? Some person say, well, Pastor, I'm not religious. What are you talking about, spiritual resilience? You see, spirituality is based in our beliefs and our values. And very often we fail to realize that we have to have a lot of faith. We have to have a what?
A lot of faith.
When you open your fridge and you take out a carton of drink or milk, you believe that the people who have given you that, provided it, packaged it, have done what they're supposed to do. You trust them. You what? I don't see you with a test kit to see if it's safe. You trust. You put your confidence. But what will happen the day you open the fridge and you open that carton and it's not what it says it is? Your confidence is what? And when your confidence is shaken, you have to make a choice. Do you stop eating? Or do you become resilient? Do you find an adaptation? Do you find a way to regain your truth? The Christian, in the world that we are living in, where there's so much darkness and destruction, so much deception and so much distortion, the Christian relies on the Word of God and the person of the Holy Spirit to keep us on task and on track in the midst of the many destructive things that we experience. To stay strong, you need something bigger than yourself. You need God.
Amen.
The psalmist David understood this. David had been disappointed. He had even disappointed himself. And I don't know about you. It's hard enough when people let you down. But when you let down yourself, man, it hurts. Because there's nobody you can blame but. And you have to get back up. You have to what? You have to find a way to move forward. And David found it in his God. He says, the Lord is my
shepherd.
I shall not want. When I don't have it, I look to God. When I can't find it, I look to God. He is realizing that there's someone bigger than himself, Brother Blenman. He's realizing there's someone bigger than himself, Brother Grandison.
Yes.
He has to depend on someone other than him. Sister Gemma was beautiful. The testimony of how she kept the Sabbath. You know, it's not easy to keep the Sabbath like that. But she did it because of her faith.
Yes.
She did it because of her what?
Faith.
It's not something that the pastor made her do. She looked at the Word of God. It spoke to her heart and she responded.
Yes.
And when God speaks to you, he speaks to you. And when he calls you, there is nothing that can stand between you and God. Amen?
Yes.
The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in
green
pastures. He leadeth me beside
still waters.
He restores. And the Christian goes through rough times. The Christian goes through difficult times. Right now, I know the grief that is on your heart, Brother Garfield. The grief that is on your heart may feel so heavy, but there's a God who went to Calvary that you may be able to bear this.
Yes.
He was the God who held your mother in the rough times.
Yeah.
You know, when we see sweet people, we forget that sweet things have to grow.
Yes.
Amen? She may not have always been sweet, but she found a God who kept making her sweeter and sweeter every day. And as she overcame, she shared it.
Yes.
Sometimes we get so much blessings from God and we don't give anybody anything. Not even a smile. We get so full of what we have, forgetting that God gave it so that we could share it.
Yes.
He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name. Yea, though I walk. Now you see, I love sweet people because I always realize that when a person lives a sweet life, they have decided to not let anything get them down.
Yes.
You know, there's a song that says hallelujah anyhow. Never, never let your... Let me tell you something. If you really looked at your life, God is blessing you more than the devil is doing you any problems. The devil may be hurting you, but God is blessing you. And sometimes if you woke up in the morning and remembered how much you have, the bills wouldn't be so burdensome. Are you with me? If you realize how much God was taking care of you, your pressure wouldn't go up. Because there is so much that God is doing for you. We may have to face trouble and disaster, but God will keep us standing in the fight. So fight on. So what?
Fight on.
Parents, you're seeing your children in a time that seems to be unprecedented in its uncertainty. How will our children make it through COVID-19? God will provide. We may be tired and careworn, but each moment he refreshes his blessings in our need for our children as well. That's why parents now more than ever pray for your children. What's that? Turn to God and say exactly what you want. You want them to get up early?
Yes.
Ask God.
Yes.
Now, I'll share a little secret with you. People don't understand how prayer works. People think that when you pray, then you gotta go and do it.
Okay.
But what happens is this. When you pray, God, who is that?
God.
Hears your prayer.
Come on, man.
And he starts to work.
Yes.
He what?
Starts to work.
On what you can't do anything about.
Amen.
So when your child gets up one morning and says at 7 o'clock, I have an 8 o'clock appointment, I need your help.
Mm-hmm.
You're shocked. But you didn't realize that God was working far in advance. All you have to do now is get up and drop them.
Yeah.
And sometimes that's the hard part, because sometimes we are not ready for the blessing. We're not what?
Ready for the blessing.
I remember once there was a lady who we had grown apart. And I remember turning to God and saying, Lord, I would like to reconnect with this elderly old lady again. And one day, I was in the community. I was what? And the Lord told me, pass by. You see, God is already working on it. And when I knocked on the door, and the lady heard my voice, she says, it is you. I am glad you are here. God opened the door. Today, God is speaking to each of you. He's speaking to each of you because each of you have been touched in a very special way by Sister Gemma. And her witness has drawn on you and convinced you that there's some things that you need to do. There's some things you need to do in your faith, some things that you need to do in your physical life, some things you need to do in your social life, some things you need to do in your cultural experience. You need to do them. And God wants you to say to him, have thine own way, Lord. Have thine
own way.
Maybe it's a relationship that needs mending. Maybe it's a health decision you need to make. Maybe it's to start keeping the Lord's Sabbath. But the Lord is speaking to you. And he gives you a promise today. He gives you a what?
Promise.
Sister Gemma dwelt with him. And he was her help and salvation. And he makes the same promise to you. Psalm 91. He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, he is my what? Refuge and my fortress. My God, in him will I trust. Surely he shall deliver thee from the snare of the fowler, from the noisome pestilence. He shall cover thee with his feathers, and under his wings shalt thou trust. The truth shall be thy shield. And so you want to know how you're going to make it through COVID? God is saying to you, I will be with you.
Amen.
You want to know how you're going to get your family to sort it out? God is with you. And all he wants you to do is give him the chance. Be faith resilient. Be what? Call on him. Yes. Somebody said, well, Pastor, I don't go to your church. Call on him.
Amen.
But Pastor, I have not prayed for years. Call on him. But Pastor, you don't know the things I do. Call on him.
Come on,
there's nothing he can't fix. And you know what? You didn't know, but I'm telling you, you are his child. If you've forgotten, I'm letting you know, you are, you are made in his image, after his, and he wants you home. He wants you where? Because you are his. And so today, we grieve the passing of Sister Gemma, but we celebrate her faith. We celebrate her love. We celebrate her hope. And one of the biggest hopes she had is that each of you will see her when Jesus comes.
Amen.
I'm satisfied with just a cottage below, a little silver and a little gold. But in that city where the mansions are shine, I've got a gold one with silver line. I've got a mansion just over the hilltop in that bright land where we'll never grow old. And someday under we'll never more wander, but walk the streets that are purest gold.
Amen.
Dear Lord, Sister Marjorie has laid down the affairs of this life. But the testimony we have and the witness we bear is that she hath discharged her duties as your steward. She has loved those you have given her to the end. And she asks you now to be with them. She has committed them to you, and we now join in her faith and hope and love and commit them into your care. Those who are here and those who are joining us online, we ask that you will intervene and intercede in their circumstance and be the God who delivers, the God who heals, the God who strengthens. Be their God and give them faith to reach out to you and find you faithful, as the witness of our dear sister has borne, in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Our hymn of consolation is number 440, which has been termed as the Seventh-day Adventist anthem. And whenever you hear an anthem, you stand. So we invite you to stand with us as we sing this song. Zeroing on the words, how cheering is the Christian hope. That is what we saw on our daily departed. While toiling here below, it buoys us up while passing through this wilderness of war. How cheering is the Christian hope. Shall be the power of earth and never part.
That blissful home. Shall we pray? Heavenly Father, we are thankful that in your word you said to us that we mourn not as others do. We believe in your promises, and the one promise, one of the promises that you've made is that the dead in Christ will rise first, and that those of us who are alive and remain will meet them in the sky. We look forward with great hope to the sweet by and by, where we can and we will be with our dear sister. May each of us determine in our hearts that we too will be there on that blessed morn. Hear our prayer for Christ's sake. Amen.
The pallbearers will proceed first, and then we will file out orderly, remembering our social distancing. Thank you.
Marjorie Jemmett, my aunt, better known as Auntie, was Auntie to everyone. She was the kindest person that I've ever known. She had a great sense of humor, sometimes very dry. and she loved to laugh. Auntie was there for us, whether it be babysitting when we were young or giving financial and moral support whenever she can. She was a good listener. She had the ability to interact with the young and the old. We still speak of the good deeds that Auntie has done for us. Auntie loved to socialize. Whenever and wherever there was a family gathering, Auntie was there. Auntie loved to go to the airport to bid farewell to whoever was returning abroad. All she needed to know was the date and the time of the departure, and she was there even before you arrive. She was courageous. She loved to travel. Even in her advanced age, she arrived in Canada ready for a new adventure. At 80 years old, I believe, or older, she visited England to see Uncle, who was ill at the time. I recall putting Auntie on a train from London to Manchester, traveling alone. We were hoping and praying that she would arrive safely after the three-hour journey. She was all smiles when Cousin Trevor picked her up at the other end. Auntie had a deep faith in God, and she did not like missing church on Saturdays. In Canada and in England, Auntie made sure she found a Seventh-day Adventist church that she can attend each Saturday. She quickly made friends, and very soon she was being picked up, taken to church, and brought back home by a church member. We will always remember our aunt. She is a unique person. There will never be another auntie because she is the last of her siblings. She will be greatly missed. On behalf of myself and Mac, Carrie and Akeem, Maria, Ariana and Malcolm, we are deeply saddened by Auntie's passing. We love you, Auntie. May you rest in the arms of the Almighty Father. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Maria Daniel, the great niece to Marjorie Jennett, also known as Auntie to us and known as sister to the community. And my fondest memories of her were when she would come to the airport to see us off, or she'd be at the airport when we'd arrive, and she was always on the go with her big heavy bag that she carried absolutely everything in. She was incredibly hardworking, incredibly attentive, and so witty. Auntie was a jokester. She would always laugh, she would always smile, she'd always be telling stories. She loved to reminisce. She loved to share anecdotes. She was helping me build out the Jemmett family tree. She was so keen to talk. She was a really, really good person, really kind, really genuine, really honest, you know, never hold back what she thought. She was very honest. She was also very pragmatic. And when my grandmother, Gloria, passed, I asked Auntie how she was feeling about it, and she looked me dead in the eye and just said, when it's your time, it's your time, and that there's nothing to be afraid of. I know that she was accepting of death, and she knew that God had other plans for her, and she was ready. So she'll be sorely missed by us, by my family, by the community. She will be very missed.
I'm gonna get a picture of you. Say cheese.
first song for the group, right? Okay. At this time, we'll have a word of prayer. Let us pray. The first song that we are going to sing begins with a question. Shall we gather at the river where bright angels' feet have trod, with its crystal tide forever flowing by the throne of God? And here comes the answer. Unreservedly, yes, we'll gather at the river, the beautiful river. Gather with the saints at the river that flows by the throne of God. Heavenly Father, we are thankful for that promise. We come here this morning in a service of thanksgiving. Yes, there's a bit of sorrow because we missed the separation. But we are thanking you for the life of our dearly departed in the many and various ways in which you have touched us. We want to thank you, Lord, for giving her to us. And each of us are better for having been with her. As we continue now in this service, as we sing these songs, may they go up like sweet incense before your throne, so that your blessings indeed would come down. Hear our prayer, for Christ's sake. Amen.
For as much as God in his infinite love and wisdom has permitted our dear sister Marjorie Onitha Jemon to fall asleep in Christ, we do tenderly commit her body to the ground, earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust, in the sure and certain hope of a joyful resurrection when our Lord shall return in glory. Then his body of our humiliation shall be changed and made like unto his glorious body, according to the mighty working whereby he is able even to subdue all things unto himself. Amen. Our first song, Shall We Gather at the River, immediately after the center of your song sheet. Psalm 32, blessed is he whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Blessed is the man whom the Lord does not impute iniquity, and in whose spirit there is no deceit.
When I kept silence, my bones grew old through my groanings all the day long. For day and night, your hand was heavy upon me. My vitality was turned into drop. Of summer, I acknowledged my sin to you, and my iniquity I have not hidden. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave the iniquity of my sin. For this cause, everyone who is godly shall pray to you in a time when you may be found. Surely in a flood of great waters, they shall not compass near him. You are my hiding place. You shall preserve me from trouble. You shall surround me with the songs of deliverance. I will instruct you and teach you in the way you should go. I will guide you with mine eyes. Do not be like unto the horse or like the mule, which have no understanding, which must be harnessed with bit and bridle, else they will not come near you. Many sorrows shall be to the wicked, but he who trusts in the Lord, mercy shall surround him. We continue with the singing, How Cheering Is the Christian's Hope. Oh, sorry. Rock of Ages. Thank you. Over the page. Rock of Ages. Psalm 1, Blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the path of sinners, nor sits in the seat of the scornful. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in this law doth he meditate day and night. He shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water, that bringeth forth fruit in his season, whose leaf shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. The ungodly are not so, but are like the chaff which the wind driveth away. Therefore the ungodly shall not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord knows the way of the righteous, but the way of the ungodly shall perish. We continue with, When the roll is called up yonder, when the trumpet of the Lord shall sound, and time shall be no more, and the morning breaks eternal, bright and fair, when the saved of earth shall gather over on the other shore, and the roll is called up yonder. I'll be there.
And the saved of love shall gather
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found, was blind, but now I see.
Yeah.
This evening, we would like to thank you on behalf of the family of the late Sister Marjorie Gemmon. Thank you all for coming. I express condolences on behalf of Pastor Marshall, who, because of personal reasons, could not be here today. But he keeps the family in his prayer. At this time, our prayers go with you as a family in comfort and in grace as we look for the soon coming of the Lord with the daily departing. God bless you.
As I listen to the music playing, sounds to me as though the passing of the guard. And I believe that somewhere, if it were possible, Sister Gemmon would have passed the guard to Brother Garfield and said to him, "See you in glory." And she would have wanted to say, "Weep not for me, though I have gone into that gentle night. Grieve if you will, but not for long. Upon my soul's sweet flight, I am at peace. My soul's at rest. There's no need for tears. For with your love, I was so blessed. For all those many years, there is no pain. I suffer not. The fear is now all gone. Put now these things out of your thoughts. In your memory I live on. Remember not my flight for breath. Remember not the strife. Please do not dwell upon my death, but celebrate." Let us pray. Heavenly Father, as we depart from this place where we have laid our dearly beloved Sister Gemmon to rest, we pray, Lord, that you would encircle all of these family members and friends, in particular her son Garfield, and all the nieces and the wonderful family extensions that she had. We pray, Lord, that you would cover them all in your precious blood, that you would surround them with all of heaven's richest blessings, that you, Lord, would be with them in days when the days are dreary and the long nights weary. We pray, Lord, that you would assure them that you are there to comfort and to cheer when they need it most. Continue to be with them all. Continue to be with this family and comfort them in every waking moment when their heart pain and they feel that separation. Lord, you be with them. Continue to bless them and provide for them abundantly above all they can think, ask or desire. And Lord, and when the roll is called up yonder, we pray that they all will be there to meet our sister in glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
For your support. Thank you for your prayers. I wish to thank the Downs and Wilson Funeral Home and the staff and the members of Downs and Wilson Funeral Home for the good work that they have done. And I wish to thank all of you for coming out here to support us as we mourn the passing of our dear aunt. I pray that God will continue to bless you, and as she has made her way, may we also prepare our way to meet her in heaven. Thank you to the videographers, to everyone. May God bless you.